Comprised of a sealed tube coated on the inside with phosphor powder and filled with usually argon and a tiny bit of mercury, the way in which fluorescent bulbs produce light is extremely fascinating. I'm looking at fluorescent bulbs right now. While the underlying physical mechanisms in the fixture and bulb can vary a bit in design, in a nutshell, a fluorescent light works via two electrodes at either end of the tube, emitting electrons as they heat up. Eventually, an arc is created via varying mechanisms depending on the fixture and bulb design, with the electrons shooting across the bulb through the ionized gas from one electrode to the other. As they move through the tube, the tiny bit of mercury in the bulb is vaporized, and as the electrons collide with its atoms, it excites the electrons in the atoms to higher energy levels. However, this higher energy level is unstable, and post-collision, as the electrons rapidly return to their original energy level, they release photons, albeit mostly ultraviolet, UV light that we humans just can't see. None of this is very useful as a light source at this point. The photons in the UV light, however, in turn excite the electrons in the phosphor that is coating the bulb, similarly causing them to move away from their nuclei to a higher state. The phosphor electrons then quickly return to their original state, at which point they also release energy in the form of photons, but this time mostly in the human visible spectrum, creating the bulk of the visible light that makes these bulbs useful in office buildings the world over. Oh my god, I had no idea how insanely complicated this was. Okay, now let's talk about the buzzing. Absent preventative measures, the current in the fluorescent tube would rise to dangerous levels owing to the fact that the electrical resistance of the ionized gas in the tube drops progressively as it heats up. So, without something put in place to stop the current rising too much, this would be a cascading problem. Eventually, it could well flip your circuit breaker, or the bulb could even explode. Whatever the case, your lights would quickly stop working. To manage that, fluorescent bulb fixtures are equipped with a ballast of some sort. This ballast classically comes in the form of an iron core wrapped in copper wire. The result is a device that slows the current's growth, keeping it at a safe level for the bulb to operate efficiently. Important to the discussion of buzzing is that the electricity energizes this ballast into producing a magnetic field. This is, in fact, how this type of ballast works in the first place. As more current is passed through, the magnetic field gets bigger, opposing the change in the current flow, and thus slowing its growth enough for the alternating current, AC, to switch directions, with it dropping to zero and going back up in the opposite direction in the process. Standard alternating current rates are usually 60 Hz, aka 60 cycles per second, such as in the United States, or 50 Hz, such as in the UK. Aptly named for half of an AC cycle, the current's charge moves in one direction, and for the second half, the charge moves in the other. All of this switching back and forth further affects the ballast's electromagnetic field, since each time the current switches direction, every half cycle, the polarity of the magnet also switches. So, since the electromagnet is fluctuating at twice the frequency of the AC current, its flicker rate is at 100 Hz or 120 Hz, depending on which country you're in. During these fluctuations in magnetic field, the ballast's core is physically squeezed and released in a process called magnetorestriction. That, at a frequency of either 100 or 120 Hz, produces that infamous buzz. Of course, not all of the buzzers are alike, and this is due to differences in the fixture's ballast type, size, how the ballast is mounted, fixture design, and the degree to which the ceilings, walls, sheet metal, etc., muffle or amplify the sound. Such a common nuisance, the industry publishes sound ratings for ballasts, and even recommends in which settings different ratings are appropriate. For example, those ballasts with an A rating are the quietest, 20 to 24 decibels, and they are recommended for libraries, churches, reception areas, and in TV and radio stations. Here we are, very quiet fluorescent bulbs. Then there's the C level, which is 31 to 36 decibels, and is recommended for general office areas, and then there's retail stores, which can get away with D ratings at about 37 to 42 decibels. For those who hate the buzzing, or perhaps have issues with migraine headaches being induced by the fluorescent bulbs and their flickering light, electronic ballast, as opposed to the old-school magnetic ones, are available, and are even quite common today, such as those found in compact fluorescent bulbs, CFLs. These ballasts typically operate at a drastically higher rate than 100 Hz or 120 Hz, usually in excess of 20,000 Hz. It should be noted, though, that if you switch to one of these electronic ballasts in your older fluorescent fluorescent light fixture, something that is surprisingly cheap to do, you then need to swap out your fluorescent bulbs to a variety that are rated to work with your new ballast. And who said you never learned anything practical on Today I Found Out? Now for a bonus fact. Ever wonder why black lights make certain things glow? Well, wonder no more. Black lights are not that different from any other type of light, whether that's incandescent, fluorescent, or just an old candle. The difference is that black lights emit most of their light waves just outside the range that humans can perceive, in the ultraviolet UV part of the spectrum. When a UV light wave hits an object containing phosphors, those phosphors will naturally fluoresce and glow as previously described, with how fluorescent lights convert UV light to light in the human visible spectrum via phosphor coating the bulb. As you might have guessed from this, the construction of bulbs that create UV light is fairly simple, though there are several different ways to go about making black lights, with two main designs being most commonly used. The tube blacklight is very similar in design to a standard fluorescent bulb that we previously described. The main difference is in the phosphorus coating. Instead of creating light in the visible spectrum, the coating absorbs UVB and UVC light waves and creates UVA waves. Black glass tubes will naturally block out the small amount of visible light created by the energized mercury, so that most of what comes through is UV light and a small amount of visible wavelengths of light that are closest to the UV spectrum, those being shades of dark blue and violet. This is why black lights appear to be a shade of purple to the naked eye. The second type of common black light is an incandescent black light bulb. These work more or less the same way as any old-style standard household incandescent bulb. The difference between the two is the filter that is added to the bulb. All of the light that is created by the heated filament is filtered out, except those waves in the infrared and UVA spectrum. The filter absorbs the rest, which is why this type of black light tends to get extremely hot, even for an incandescent bulb, and they have a short lifespan. Incidentally, beyond looking for blood, urine, and semen on your hotel sheets, just don't do that. Why would you do that? Another ingenious use for black lights is to diagnose certain types of bacterial infections. You see, some bacteria naturally fluoresce under UV light, and as such, certain infections can be diagnosed by shining a black light on the patient. One such type of infection is caused by a bacteria known as Pseudomonas. This type of bacteria has 191 species and is the second leading cause of infections in hospitals. So, I really hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, smash that like button. Don't forget to subscribe. Also, why not check out another channel I do called Geographics? It's a channel all about geography. What a surprise! Find that link to below. And thank you for watching.